sounds so natural.
We're ready? Okay. This is the panel on humanist activism and political action, rather. And we have two speakers today. My name is Susan Sackett, and I will be introducing them. And we will hear first from James Croft, and then later we will hear from Bishop McNeill. James, whom I've known for a while now as a big Star Trek fan, he is also a humanist activist, organizer, public speaker, and he graduated from the universities of Cambridge and Harvard, which happens to be located in Cambridge, Mass. And he's been studying for his doctorate at the Harvard Graduate School of Education. He's also an ethical culture teacher in training and co-author with Greg Epstein, who is at the Harvard, is also at Harvard, of the forthcoming book, The Godless Congregation, to be published soon by Simon & Schuster. And please welcome James Croft.
Let's see, I'm a little short, so let's see if, can everybody hear me if I speak like this? Okay, great. You can probably tell from my accent that I'm not from around here. I'm from the motherland, the UK, so it's very uncomfortable for me to be here in Philadelphia. This hotbed of revolutionary thinking makes me very, very nervous. I'm always looking over my shoulder. When I was in my early teens, the UK government held a public consultation regarding the building of a new airport terminal at Heathrow, the largest airport in London and one of the most important international airports in the world. Now, I grew up in a leafy suburb in southwest London, which, although a beautiful place to live, had the misfortune of lying directly under the flight path to Heathrow Airport. And many of the residents in my area were against the building of Terminal 5. They feared that if it was built, more airplanes would fly overhead and ruin their charming garden parties and their tea time and things like that. Indeed, resistance to Terminal 5 was so strong that nearly every house on our street had a poster in the front window saying, "Terminate Terminal 5." Every house, that is, except ours. You see, my mother worked for British Airways at the time, and had done for many, many years, and so she was supportive of the building of the new terminal. She thought all these other people were NIMBYs who didn't understand how useful it would be to the local economy and to the city as a whole. And so we, alone on our entire street, had a poster in our window saying, "Time to back T5. And she thought that it would be educational, challenging, amusing to send me, as a young teenager, out one day to gather support for the new terminal among the people in our neighborhood. So I set out, 13 years old or so, with a clipboard and a pen and a petition to convince my neighbors to support that they actually really wanted to support the terminal, that they actually wanted to terminate. That was an interesting and a little bit difficult experience. I've never had the door shut on my face so many times in my life. That's, of course, until I work for the Liberal Democrat Party. But let's not talk about that. So politics has been in my blood since my childhood. And the same can be said of humanism. I want to give you a quote, and I want you to think whether you know where this quote is from. "We are firmly convinced that the existing acquisitive and profit-motivated society has shown itself to be inadequate, and that a radical change in methods, controls, and motives must be instituted. A socialized and cooperative economic order must be established to the end that the equitable distribution of the means of life be possible. Our goal is a free and universal society in which people voluntarily and intelligently cooperate for the common good." Raise your hand if you know where... Yeah, you can applaud that if you want. Not so many people want to. Interesting. Raise your hand if you know where that comes from. Not so many people. So where was it?
Pope Francis.
No, not Pope Francis in the Catholic Church. Who else?
Marx.
Although, huh? It sounds like Marx, right? It could have come from the Communist Manifesto. It was influenced by communism, but it wasn't from the manifesto. Yeah.
Mussolini?
No, not Mussolini.
Sidney.
It was the Humanist Manifesto. That is a quote from the first Humanist Manifesto calling explicitly for a socialized and cooperative economic order. How about this one? To enhance freedom and dignity, the individual must experience a full range of civil liberties in all societies. This includes freedom of speech and the press, political democracy, the legal right of opposition to governmental policies, fair judicial process, religious liberty, freedom of association, and artistic, scientific, and cultural freedom. That one from... Well, it sounds like Tom Paine. That one is much more acceptable. That's from the second Humanist Manifesto. So, humanism has always been political, both implicitly and explicitly. Humanism is fundamentally a set of values, a commitment to reason, compassion, and hope. And politics is the mechanism that we use to make change when the world doesn't reflect our ideals and values. And right now, I want to suggest to you that the world does not reflect humanist values. Let's just stick to America for the moment and take a look. If we truly believe in the equal dignity of all people, then surely we cannot abide an economic system which leaves some people in abject poverty, struggling to feed and clothe their children, while others become unimaginably, obscenely wealthy. That's inconsistent. You cannot hold the moral position that each person is morally equal and yet support an economic system which makes people so grotesquely unequal. If we believe in the importance of human reason, we must be committed to the development of reason through universal, free education for all citizens, regardless of how poor or underserved they are. If we believe in the capability of people to change our circumstances for the better, we have to support the institutions that enable us to make change, ensuring at least that everybody has an equal vote, a principle that's been under attack recently in America as people try and prevent particularly minorities and poorer people from even expressing their vote at the poll. And this is to say nothing on attacks on LGBTQ rights, on women's rights, particularly reproductive rights, the problem of climate change, which is an enormous political issue that could affect the future of our whole species, and the racist criminal justice system, and a whole host of other political issues that are directly relevant to humanist values. We do not live in America in a humanist society. And to change that, we have to get political. There is no other way. But our movement has historically been very politically weak. We haven't been very politically powerful. Susan Jacoby, excellent author and free thinker, who writes on many important topics, said in her last column for the On Faith blog, "Looking back on my 5 years as a contributor to On Faith, I see a great paradox in the progress of American secularism. The numbers and visibility of atheists and secularists in the United States have increased, but their political and social influence has not." Now, she wrote that at the end of 2011, but I think it's still true in the middle of 2014. Our political influence is very, very meager. What can we do to change this? Well, steel your stomachs. I don't want anyone to throw up their breakfast, right? But I think that we need to learn from the religious right. We need to take every page out of the religious right's playbook. Because over the past few decades, the religious right, which represents actually a very small fraction of people in the United States, has gained a hugely outsized political influence because it's used a series of political organizing strategies which we could use if we were intelligent and organized enough to do it. John Hicks is assistant, I'm not making any judgment as to whether we are intelligent or organized enough to do it. I just put that out there as a thought. John Hicks is an assistant professor of political science, and he says this about the success of the religious right. One of the keys to the religious right's electoral success is a well-organized grassroots effort, which is driven by its members' dedication and belief in the importance of the cause. The religious right uses grassroots efforts of local groups to lobby at local and state levels, not primarily nationally, in ways which support things that reflect their values. And my argument today is that we should do that too. We should start locally, not nationally. Yes, you can applaud that if you want. There we go. That's what I like to hear. Now I know I'm doing some valuable work. We should start locally by creating a network of local humanist organizations which harness their members' dedication and belief in the importance of humanist values to make a difference politically. And that is basically the opposite of how we've tended to organize our movement up until now. We tend to have national organizations which have no local constituencies. And I think that is precisely the wrong mode of political organization. We need to have local organizations that then lead up to national significance. So the first thing I think that we should do, if you want to have political influence as a humanist, is join and build your local humanist organizations. If you want to promote humanist values in America, start or get more involved in your local humanist organizations. So that, let me give you an example of that. At Harvard, we have been building over the past 6 or so years, and really for many years, what is now the Humanist Hub. It is a genuine local community center for atheists, agnostics, skeptics, freethinkers, humanists, and everyone in between, which hosts many groups from around the Boston area. We host the Sunday Assembly sometimes. We host the Ethical Society of Boston, the Greater Boston Humanists. We have all sorts of organizations having events at our space. It is a genuine community center for humanist life in the Harvard area. It has our values painted on the wall, right? It's actually really, really cool. And it is an awesome space. This is the opening of it. In fact, there's more people than you can see, or not really see, in this dark photo, because this is a widescreen photo and it extends to both past both edges of the crop there. There's a lot of people there, and there's a lot of people who join our community. And it's already had an effect in our local area, to the extent that on December the 8th, the governor of Massachusetts, Deval Patrick, declared it Humanist Community Day in Massachusetts. That's actually quite significant. Yeah. I'll take it. I take none of the credit for that. But that is actually, it's not the biggest thing in the world, but it's part of the way you increase your political and cultural influence by building a local community that's visible, that people can actually visit and see and participate in, and then politicians start to notice that you've got voters attached to your values. So I'm asking you to join these organizations, whether they're Center for Inquiry or an Ethical Society or an AHA chapter or a Unitarian Universalist Humanist Congregation or a Free Thought Church or a Sunday Assembly or whatever it is. I don't care which one of them you get involved in. Get involved in that, and that will build our political influence over time. I'm talking over like many decades. This is going to be a long-term project. The second thing I think we need to do is get more comfortable working with allies. We have natural political allies in many areas: liberal religious groups, LGBTQ organizations, organizations working for the rights of immigrants and people of color. We have to recognize that our movement is simply too small to make major political change alone. But we don't have to make major political change alone. We have to restrain our desire to achieve ideological purity at every opportunity and accept a certain political pragmatism, make some uncomfortable alliances to make genuine progress towards humanist political ends. So, for example, I think it would be great if at conferences like this, as well as representatives of explicitly humanist and atheist organizations, we had representatives from groups like the ACLU and the NAACP and the Dreamers for Immigration Reform and all those sorts of organizations who work on issues that are close to the hearts of humanists. After all, the ACLU and NAACP was founded in part by humanists, so they should be here. Okay, we could have the Democratic Party as well if we must. And well, we could talk about that at great length. But the third issue that I think we should do is recognize, and this is a personal plea, that humanism is politically is about much more than secularism. Now, I have this slide to remind me to say at this point that I love secularism. Secularism is a very, very important political issue, and it feeds into a lot of other important political issues. But humanism is a much broader set of ideals and values than secularism is. And a narrow focus on issues of secularism in the movement is debilitating to humanism as a whole and actually dangerous to the advancement of secularism as an ideal. We need to talk as a movement about criminal justice reform, about universal health care as a civil right for all, about rampant wealth inequality in this country and in the world, about climate change. If we're only talking about secularism and how to get the latest cross off government property, two things will happen. Firstly, we will associate the idea of secularism more closely with atheism and drive away religious people who would otherwise support secularism. That is already happening in America over the past few years. And secondly, if we don't speak about these issues from a humanist perspective, there will be no movement in America talking about human welfare in the broadest possible sense from a non-theistic perspective. If we don't do it, there will be no non-theistic values-based movement which talks about the great social and political issues of our time. And I want there to be such a movement. That's why I'm here. It's my firm belief that in these first decades of the 21st century, the world cries out for a non-theistic values-based movement. Nothing, I think, would do the human species more good than a locally organized, politically engaged humanist movement. And to secure our future as a species, we have to fight at every level of society, from school boards to the Senate House, from town halls to the White House. And we must fight not just for secularism, but for freedom, for economic justice, an end to structural oppression. And that's the reason I'm a humanist. That's the reason I've decided to dedicate my career and my life to humanism. And it's the reason I'm here today. So I'm asking, as I finish up my last 1 minute, will you join me in that effort to make humanism more political? And if you will, then there's three things you can do for me, right, to help my work out. This is where I do my plug. You go to Facebook and like my page. So you can see everything that I do. Follow me on Twitter, follow my blog, and then when we get more politically engaged, I can tell you about what things are going on in your community that you get involved in. So join local organizations, build alliances with relevant humanist groups and non-humanist groups that share our values, and talk about more than secularism. Please, do it for me. Okay, I'm done.
That was excellent. I hope we're all ready to go out there and do all these things. By the way, I love Terminal 5 in London. our next speaker is our very own Bishop, Bishop McNeill. And he is a political coordinator at the Center for Humanist Activism. He previously served as a field organizer, regional field director, and campaign manager on a number of political campaigns. McNeill, or Bishop, graduated magna cum laude from Fayetteville State University and completed a fellowship with the Institute of Political Leadership at the University of North Carolina in Greensboro. Please welcome Bishop McNeill.
Good morning, everybody. When James and I were talking about this, I knew he was a very dynamic speaker, and following him would be a task for me, and he did a great job, but I will try my best. I want to start with something that Bonnie Frank said last night. If we as humanists hope to achieve greater influence politically, we can't demonize or ridicule our opposition. We should also try to find areas of common ground that we can work together on, and there are obvious effective ways of political activism and ineffective ways of political activism that many of you may have saw last night. Historically, this has been the path of most disenfranchised or underrepresented groups. In their efforts to increase equality, change happens gradually in politics. That's just how it works. This is a product of the system of government that our founders created. They didn't want bills to be able to be passed and signed into law easily unless the House, Senate, and President all voted in favor. In their opinion, if this happens, the general will of the public has been met. What's interesting is this. This system of government that stops humanism, our movement, from having an immediate impact is the same system of government that protects us from the current House of Representatives, who are led by a right-wing Tea Party religious agenda, from pushing their agenda down our throats. So it's a very ironic situation and something that's worth noting. So I want to spend some time talking about how both individuals and organizations can be effective political activists. I thought it was very important that Barney Frank asked his questioners on several occasions, what did you do? It's important as individuals that we understand that we have the power to be effective activists. Lori David wrote a book called The Solution Is You, An Activist's Guide, and she outlined some tips to becoming an activist that I want to share with you this afternoon. Number one, establish what you can do for the cause. Ask yourself how much time you have, whether you want to do a little or a lot, and what talents or skills that you can bring to the table to your local organizations, as James mentioned. Determine your passion. Passion derives from awareness. Once you're aware of something in the world that you believe needs changing, that awareness will dog you constantly and cause you to see the need everywhere, bringing a sense of responsibility with it. Number three, always believe that you can make a difference. There are occasional arguments that start, how much good can one individual do? Which then turns into feelings that it all may be too hard, which can then turn into a willingness to resort to maintaining the status quo. Avoid that type of thinking because dedicated and persistent people can make a difference. Number four is be realistic. Activism may be about changing thinking slowly rather than achieving the actual change that we want to see immediately. In this case, it is wise to understand the possibility that during your lifetime, you may be at the front of simply paving the way for eventual change, then viewing it actually occurring. Understanding this can help alleviate a sense of frustration, doom, and resentment that can set in. Now, there are several ways that an individual can be an activist. Number one, you can raise awareness in your community. Talk to your friends, family, neighbors, colleagues about the issues you care about, showing how certain political action taken could impact their lives. Make the connection to them on the issues that you care about. Write letters. It's still a very effective strategy. You can write letters of concern to your elected officials or local media outlets requesting that they pay attention to a particular issue or to take a specific action on a current piece of legislation. Try to tell your personal story and the negative impact a certain action could have on your life. Request meetings with your elected officials. Barney Frank mentioned this as well last night. Basically, the goal here is the same as writing letters, but face-to-face persuasive communication is the most effective. So if you can get in the offices, likely you will not meet with your representative, you'll meet with their staff, but they're the ones who write the speeches and write the legislation and the bills, so they have direct, you know, contact with their legislatures. And if you're lucky, you might be able to meet with your elected official. Finally, as James mentioned, organize, organize, organize. Local organizing is so important for activists. Power is in numbers. But you as an individual activist can be leaders in your local organizations if they are available. If they are not available, then you should consider starting a local organization, and our organization, the Center for Humanist Activism, will provide you with resources to do that. So this leads me to my next point about how organizations can become more politically active in their communities. First, I want to outline what you can and can't do as a 501c3 organization. Many people have questions about this. Many of you are affiliated and a part of AHA chapters or other secular groups that are most likely organized as 501c3s. So 501c3 organizations cannot directly or indirectly participate in or intervene in any political campaign on behalf of or in opposition to any political candidate. Any contributions to political campaign funds or public statements of position made on behalf of the organization in favor of or in opposition to any candidate for public office clearly violate the prohibition against political campaign activity. Violating this prohibition could lead to serious penalties, including the denial or revocation of tax-exempt status, as well as the imposition of certain excise taxes and fees. But there are certain activities or expenditures by 501c3s that are allowed depending on the facts and circumstances, which is what I want to stress to you guys is that there are some political activities that your local groups can be involved in. For example, certain voter education activities, including presenting public forums with candidates on both sides and publishing voter education guides, conducted in a nonpartisan manner, are not considered prohibited political campaign activities. So your local groups can do voter education drives, voter registration drives, candidate forums, and et cetera. In addition, other activities intended to encourage people to participate in the electoral process, such as voter registration, as I mentioned, and get out the vote drives, would not be prohibited and are allowable. So again, get out the vote drives and voter registration are two things that can increase turnout in your area and could help, you know, push a political agenda that us as humans want to see happen. 501c3 organizations also can spend a small amount of time lobbying their legislators. The time that is allowed depends on the overall budget of that 501c3. And the IRS and FEC, that basically the regulation is all it says is you can't spend a significant amount of your budget or time on lobbying. So what that number is you have to, you know, do some consulting with legal or with IRS to find out what that number is for your organization. But you can spend a small amount of time lobbying your current representatives. The Center for Humanist Activism, which is my organization, we'll be sending out political training packets to all the local groups within our movement, all AHA chapters, all SCA, any secular or humanist groups, you know, local groups, your leaders will be receiving a political training packet from the Center for Humanist Activism, which includes more detailed guidelines on what political activities are allowed by nonprofit organizations. In addition, the packets will have information on how to run a voter registration drive, to how to effectively lobby in small groups. So this information will also be available online on our website at www.humanistactivism.org. Our organization hopes to provide the resources needed for local groups to become more effective political activists in their local communities, as James mentioned, is so important. So whether it's top down or bottom up, whether it's the national, you know, spearheading the movement to the local, or whether it's the local, either way, we have to have some coordination between what we're doing in DC and what the local groups are doing on the ground. We have to do better with that. So I want to conclude by talking about the current state of the humanist movement and why the time is now to increase our political activities. To measure the continued need for a political organization which is dedicated to helping elect leaders who promote a secular government and represent the rights of all Americans, including the 20% who are non-religious, we can analyze three observable criteria and monitor those changes over time. The first is polling and survey research. A 2012 USA Today Gallup poll updated a question first asked in 1937 about the public's willingness to vote for presidential candidates from a variety of different backgrounds, genders, religions. The poll asked Americans whether they would vote for a generally well-qualified presidential candidate nominated by their party with each of the following characteristics: Jewish, Catholic, Mormon, an atheist, a woman, black, Hispanic, homosexual, 72 years of age, and someone married for the third time. So the following lists some of the key findings of the last two polls that were conducted. So in 2007, an atheist has the hardest time getting elected, with only 45% of Americans saying they would vote for a qualified atheist candidate. Those who have attended college are in general more likely to support candidates with any of the characteristics than those with a high school education or less. In regards to atheists, 52% of college-educated Americans would support an atheist versus only 32% of Americans with a high school diploma or less. When broken down by ideology, political ideology, 67% of liberals, 48% of moderates, and 29% of conservatives say they would vote for an atheist presidential candidate. So in 2012, Atheists would still seem to have the hardest time getting elected. However, 54% of Americans now say they would vote for an atheist presidential candidate. An atheist, at least 7 in 10 young adults, those under age 30, would vote for a presidential candidate of any background. However, fewer than half of senior citizens will vote for a candidate who is gay, an atheist, or a Muslim. So here's the trend over the years. 1958, 18% said they would vote for an atheist. 1978, 40%. 1983, 42%. 1987, 44%. 1999, 49%. 2007, 45%. I don't know why that decreased. But 2012, 54%. So the needle is moving towards more acceptance of atheism. Yeah. Americans over time have generally become more accepting of presidential candidates from various backgrounds. However, there are still certain types of candidates, specifically atheists, that Americans would have a harder time supporting. Even so, a majority of Americans say they would vote for such a candidate. Keep in mind that the polling is from a national scientific sample of Americans, and these numbers will shift district to district. There's a Pew Research Forum also conducted a survey in 2012 which tracked the rising numbers of Americans who don't identify with any religion. In the last 5 years alone, the nones have increased from just over 15% to fewer than 20% of all U.S. adults. In the same time period, the number of self-described atheist agnostic rose from 3.7% to 5.7% of the U.S. population. So the numbers are moving in the right direction for atheist acceptance. And I want to thank you guys for the opportunity to talk to you today.
Okay, thank you to both of our speakers. If you would like to ask a question, not make a long statement, as you've been hearing about that, please line up at the microphone. We do have about 10 more minutes. So our first question, and you can direct it to either or to both of our speakers.
Sure. Well, thank you both for really wonderful comments this morning and all the work you're doing in helping to fire up our movement to do this political work, which is so critical. A quick little detailed question, which I think is an important one, is the question of, like, in the significant versus small amount of resources that any organization can apply to doing lobbying, is it for any expenses, or is it specifically for paid staff versus, say, volunteer effort? Would it be covered? And I just want to clarify also that if anyone is doing voter registration drive, you have to turn in all forms. You can't just turn in the ones you like. It's just a little detail, very important. You get in big trouble, organizations have. But thanks again for the work you're doing, and I'm just wanting to clarify that one point.
Right, and I mean, it's a good question. Volunteers, obviously, as volunteers can, as long as you're not acting on behalf of the 501c3 nonprofit, volunteers can do and organize however they want to, as long as you're not acting on behalf or using any funds that are related to the 501c3. Generally, the substantial amount is around no more than 15 to 20% of your general budget can be spent on lobbying. So that is a general guideline, but it's not set in stone.
Arthur Jackson from San Jose, California. The last issue of the Humanist magazine, the May-June issue, had an article on benefit corporations. And to my mind, that presents a model that could essentially move our economic system in a humanist, in an explicitly humanist way. And I'm wondering if trying to promote that kind of a thing, to encourage corporations to reincorporate, to become benefit corporations rather than being stuck only with the greatest profits for the shareholders, if there's any way of that would fit into what you're thinking about in terms of this kind of effort.
I actually haven't read this most recent article of The Humanist. I hesitate to admit that in this company. I apologize if the editor is in the room. But it sounds like, I'll take the question a little more broadly. I think that we have to talk about economics. We have to be willing to say, these economic arrangements seem, according to the evidence, to produce more human welfare and flourishing than these other economic arrangements. And our economic arrangement right now, do with laws governing corporations, taxation law, and all sorts of other aspects of the economic apparatus, are not optimal. We can at least say they're not producing the optimal amount of welfare they could be producing. That doesn't entail a commitment to any specific economic ideology, but it certainly entails a commitment to changing the status quo into something that's demonstrably likely to be better. And so that sort of thing is exactly the sort of thing we should investigate using our reason, our intellect, to think through whether it's really going to be a good idea. But I think that that is the sort of thing that humanist organizations should get involved about talking about. We shouldn't be scared to address economic and sort of business-related issues. I think that they're inherently, people's work lives and the money that they get to survive from their work, or don't in some cases, are an essential part of their existence as a human being. And if humanism can't talk about that, then we're cutting off a huge part of human life, which we should be able to talk about. Mm-hmm. So in theory, yes.
Okay, next.
Thank you both for your presentations. Pat Colucci with New Jersey Humanist Network. James, really appreciated and agree with your presentation. I want to thank you for that. Bishop, I have a specific question. You laid out some of the do's and don'ts of what a 501c3 should do. I wanted to try to put a little finer point, if I may. Could a 501c3 group do something like inform and educate its members about an issue, let's say global warming, and say, you know, this is what we as a group think about this issue, not talking about candidates, and how we think this issue is important, and here's why, and so forth and so on. But, and then we encourage you, members of our group, as individuals, to go ahead and get involved in political campaigns based on your own decisions, based upon what you feel about the issue. So in other words, informing the group's members and then encouraging them as individuals to go out and do something active in a political campaign of their own choosing, on their own as individuals. Is that something that could be done and is allowed?
Absolutely.
Yes?
Absolutely. There is absolutely nothing regulating that would prohibit that type of activity.
Okay.
There is absolutely nothing prohibiting that type of activity. 501c3s absolutely can engage its members on the issues that of concern to their, you know, movement. And it can also encourage its members to volunteer and be more active politically. Absolutely.
And just to add something to that answer, all the sociological evidence demonstrates that if people are members of local values-based communities, like religious congregations, they will be very significantly more civically engaged. They will volunteer more. They'll give more of their money and time to organizations they care about. The averages out to be about twice as engaged as someone who's not a member of a local organization, which is one of the reasons why the religious right has such an outsized political influence, because its members are massively more engaged in the political process than secular people are.
I am wondering what role direct action can and should play. For instance, on the pledge, if a public meeting opens up with the pledge, my practice has been, I will say it, but when I reach one nation, I keep on saying, indivisible, and I can justify it very well without even saying I'm an atheist. I do not want anything dividing the words one nation from the word indivisible. and possibly free thought organizations should also open with the pledge and say it the way I learned it back in 1936.
Okay, do you have a question?
Secondly, when there's a public prayer, just as Kennedy said, we don't have to listen to it. Okay, if I am by myself, I'll just keep on reading or making notes. If there's a group of three or four or more, we can just keep on talking quietly until the prayer is over. In the Bible Belt...
Sir, I'm sorry. We're going to have to move along. Do you have a question?
Would have to have a lot more courage.
Yes.
As okay. In the civil rights movement of the 60s.
Thank you. Okay. We're running short of time, so if you could kind of ask your questions quickly.
I do like the idea of engaging issues of the time, like global warming, that kind of stuff, but they can get sticky because there can be a wide variety of methods towards that aim. And you can turn off people by being too extreme, like, do you have concern about maybe being too extreme and when you try to address an issue, turning off some people? Because methods can be really difficult in like issues like global warming or income inequality. I prefer like scientific advancement. Other people prefer other methods. How do you feel about dealing with the issues with different opinions on when you want to address an issue?
I guess, in theory, you can always turn people away by your approach to any particular issue. I think that the challenge for the humanist movement is that it has tended to avoid issues where there is significant disagreement among humanists rather than address them at all. So we just don't talk about economic inequality, for instance, because some humanists are Republicans and some humanists are socialists and things like that. That, I think, is deadly. You cannot have a values-based movement that's unwilling to take a stand. I would rather alienate some people and have a smaller, more committed movement to a more clear set of values than just to have a big tent in which people bicker over the big issues of the day. Because frankly, if people who don't agree with with certain core ideas that seem very easily justifiable based on our values, they can build their own movement. And I don't have to be part of that, and they don't have to be part of the movement I'm part of. So it doesn't bother me enormously. If people are... It depends on what the proposal is, but that's my general...
There could be different methods to a problem.
Yes, I agree with that.
James, Bishop, thank you very much for your talks. My name is Emil Volchek, president of the Baltimore Ethical Society. We've been politically engaged, and one of our strategies, being a 501c3, is to work with other organizations, something that you were alluding to. For example, for marriage equality, we're with the Marylanders for Marriage Equality, also the Maryland Coalition for Trans Equality, Citizens Against State Executions. And I'm trying to understand how can a group like us, can we work with the Center for Humanist Activism as a kind of umbrella? Can we affiliate ourselves? Because when we act as the Ethical Society, we're a 501c3, we're limited in both time and money that can be spent on advocacy. But when we partner with other organizations and do it under their banner, so to speak, we send volunteers, they know the volunteers are coming from the Ethical Society when we've got a table at a phone bank, and is there opportunities that we can work with you?
Yeah, absolutely, and that's one of the misconceptions is how much coordination can happen between the 501c3s and 501c4s. To answer your question, yes, absolutely. 501c4, the purpose of the Center for Humanist Activism is to try to be this umbrella philosophy type of humanist organization that advocates for, you know, all of these issues. And so local groups if you are in a local 501c3, when you get our information, there will be information on how to sign up for the 501c4. for our Center for Humanist Activism. And that is the best way that we can combine our humanist efforts politically is through this mechanism, which is the C4. So I would strongly encourage, if you haven't already signed up to be a member of the Center for Humanist Activism, to sign up. It is free. All you have to do is go to www.humanistactivism.org and fill out the form and sign up. After that, you will receive legislative updates, action alerts, and so on. So I strongly encourage that, and I encourage, you know, the 501c groups to reach out, and we're going to reach out to you to work together and to build coalitions. So absolutely.
Okay, we're going to have to cut this short, I think, because we are running over and lunch starts in about 10 minutes. But ask your questions as briefly as possible, and that will be the last three people. Go.
Hi, my name is Sharif. I'm a director of United Secular American Center for the Elderly and Disabled. And we have 7 locations all over the United States serving the disabled, predominantly in Indian community. And as I'm also an individual with disability because of a brain surgery. My question to you, that as a not-for-profit agency, what kind of path we should take as a 501c3 to serve the community, to reach out to the community and bring more membership to our center?
That's a good question.
Yeah, I couldn't quite hear your question, but if I heard you correctly, is you're asking what are some ways that you can go back and be more politically active with your 501c3?
And increase membership.
And increase membership.
Increase membership, that's the goal. We're not an activist type of agency, we're just serving the community.
The only thing I could suggest to you is focus on is education, issue advocacy for the issues that you care about, and making connections with people outside of your group that they should have an invested interest in your concerns. I don't know, how big the movement is in your area, so you might have to pull on outside groups, alliances, people who share your interest, to do your work. That's what we have to do. In our organizations, is reach out to other groups to grow our membership. So that's what you might have to do.
Thank you.
I also would just like to thank you for raising issues related to elderly people and disabled people, which is another area of issues which is highly relevant to humanism and that we don't speak a lot about. And we could be on the forefront of pushing for more humane policies in that area.
Cheryl Viglione from Greensboro, North Carolina. Thank you for your presentations. Question, have you heard of the League of Women Voters?
Sure.
Speaking of working with allies, there is a strong one there in that. I'm a very active member of the League of Women Voters as well as a member of the AHA. The League of Women Voters has, and their membership is open to men as well, has progressive and what I would call humanistic stances and policy positions on numerous areas, including health care for all.
Okay, we're going to have to move
along,
honestly.
Comprehensive immigration reform. So I would say to the group, if you want to work with an ally, get in touch with your League of Women Voters.
Okay, last question.
In my professional work, my name is Charles Murray. In my professional work, I can tell everybody in this room, we think it's bad on the national level. We are being crushed at the state level. I could tell you about laws that would make me turn green. Can you address the issue of getting local affiliates to work together at the state level to lobby legislatures and governors?
Yeah, I mean, I think that the steps that I've outlined are the exact ways that local groups and states can be more active politically. So if you want some more information on that, just go to our website, www.humanistactivism.org.
Check your local United Core, too.
All right. I'd like to thank both of our speakers. I know everybody's anxious to get to lunch.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, James. Thank you, Bishop.
Okay. Oh, my goodness.